Ganz herzlich willkommen zur Lesung und zum Gespräch mit Jack Irvine, dessen Buch wir heute sozusagen in dieser Form vorstellen, Boys Don't Cry. Mein Name ist Katharina Pühl, ich arbeite als Referentin für feministische Gesellschafts- und Kapitalismusanalyse hier in der Stiftung. Und wir haben eine Happy Cooperation, die Taz-Tageszeitung, für die Katrin Gottschall hier ist als stellvertretende Chefredakteurin und Moderatorin des Abends. Jack via den Verlag, Jack Irvine, der Autor, und Ulrich Meinecke, der Schauspieler ist und für uns Passagen aus dem Buch lesen wird gleich. Genau. Ich bin sehr froh, dass das geklappt hat, auch noch alle Leute in den Raum zu bekommen. Ja, kurz zum Ablauf des Abends. Wir werden erst eine Passage aus dem Anfang des Buchs hören, von Ulrich gelesen. Dann wird es ein moderiertes Gespräch zwischen Katrin und Jack geben über das Buch, die Inhalte des Buchs, vielleicht auch des Buchs, auch der Rezeption, soweit es sie schon gibt. In Englisch ist es ja schon erschienen, auf Deutsch erst jetzt diese Woche. Und danach werden wir dann nochmal ein Stück gelesen bekommen aus dem Buch, eher vom Ende her. Und dann können wir in eine gemeinsame Diskussion eintreten. Katrin wird das in der Hand haben. Jan, den Sie ihr vorhin schon gesehen habt, wird mit einem Mikro rumlaufen. Und da wir das aufzeichnen, dazu sage ich gleich noch was, wäre es auch zwingend, dass jede und jeder, der spricht, in ein Mikro spricht, weil wir das dann auch auf die Website stellen werden, jeweils der drei beteiligten Institutionen. Aufzeichnung bedeutet, dass nur das Podium zu sehen ist, also die Filmaufnahme, aber bedeutet dann auch für die Diskussion, dass wenn ihr eine Frage stellt, ihr auch mit zu hören seid. Wer das nicht will, gibt uns ein Zeichen. Man kann die Frage auch auf eine Karte schreiben oder mündlich jemand mitgeben. Also wer das nicht möchte, kann sich einen anderen Weg suchen, Fragen zu stellen. Wir haben besprochen, da das Gespräch auf Englisch geführt werden wird, dass so Verständnisfragen kurz auch mal gestellt werden können, sofern es um Vokabular oder wirklich Begrifflichkeiten geht. Aber eine Diskussion, die dann inhaltlich einsteigt, wirklich erst nach der zweiten Lesung dann starten soll. Ja? Es besteht die Möglichkeit, Fragen auf Deutsch zu formulieren, die wir dann mit Jack für Jack übersetzen. Also scheut euch nicht. Ja, und dann habe ich noch eine Bitte. Wir haben auf eure Stühle ganz neoliberal unsere Evaluationsbögen gelegt. Wir legen sehr viel Wert darauf, auch in der stiftungsinternen Auswertung tatsächlich, das landet bei uns, von Publikum zu hören, was es über unsere Veranstaltung denkt. Und wir sind mega dankbar, wenn ihr ein bisschen uns helft, das zu verstehen. Und dann möchte ich noch erwähnen, dass hinten im Saal Frieda von der Buchhandlung Schwarze Risse sitzt und die Bücher des Abends und noch einige andere von Nautilus auch käuflich zu erwerben sind, falls ihr eine Originalunterschrift von Jack haben wollt. Viel Spaß.
Jack Irvine, Boys Don't Cry. Er hat mich verarscht. Da bin ich mir ganz sicher. 13 Jahre lang habe ich die letzten Worte aus dem Mund meines Vaters analysiert und ich habe nicht mehr den geringsten Zweifel, dass diese beiden Silben mit demselben finsteren Sarkasmus gesprochen wurden wie alles, was ihm je über die Lippen kam. Der Scheißkerl. Der geniale, widerliche Scheißkerl. Richard Irvines Sinn für Humor war, wie bei den meisten Vätern, gewöhnungsbedürftig. Zuweilen offenbarten die Tiefe und Komplexität seiner Witze den Verstand eines ehemaligen Mitglieds des hochbegabten Clubs Mensa International. Nach dem ersten Jahr war er zu knauserig, um seinen Mitgliedsbeitrag zu erneuern. Doch bei anderen Gelegenheiten entbehrten sie jeglichen Geistes oder Geschmacks und man fragte sich, wie Mensa bloß auf die Idee gekommen war, diesem Mann einen überdurchschnittlichen IQ zu attestieren. Mein Bruder und meine Schwester erinnern sich an einen Vorfall, bei dem unser Vater die Zeit stoppte, die Lüftung im Badezimmer noch lief, nachdem man das Licht ausgeschaltet hatte. Sie dann nach oben rief und exakt in dem Augenblick mit den Fingern schnippte, in dem die Lüftung verstummte. Und erwartete, dass seine Kinder beeindruckt waren von seiner Fähigkeit, Macht über Haushaltsgeräte auszuüben. oder wenigstens davon, dass er 7 Minuten ausgeharrt hatte, um die Zeit zu stoppen, und weitere 7 Minuten, um ihnen den Streich vorzuführen. Wenn er gewusst hätte, dass er seinen 52. Geburtstag nicht mehr erleben würde, hätte er womöglich nicht 14 Minuten seines Lebens damit vergeudet, darauf zu warten, dass eine Lüftung ausgeht. Ach, wem will ich hier was vormachen? Natürlich hätte er das. Zu unserem großen Entsetzen trug er regelmäßig hautenge Lycra-Radlerhosen, was kurios war, denn unser Leben lang hat ihn niemand von uns je Fahrrad fahren sehen. Ein Freund der Familie bemerkte einmal: Ich weiß nie, wo ich hinsehen soll, wenn Richard seine Radlershorts anhat. Wahrscheinlich ging es bei seiner Vorliebe für dieses spezielle Kleidungsstück, genau wie bei der Episode mit der Badezimmerlüftung und vielen anderen Aspekten der Persönlichkeit meines Vaters, um das, was er mehr liebte als alles andere, Leute zu verarschen. Dieser Mann hatte sich mit Leib und Seele dermaßen der Unaufrichtigkeit verschrieben, dass er, als ich ihn fragte, wie es ihm ginge, nachdem er ein paar Tage wegen Grippe nicht zur Arbeit gewesen war, aufstand und erklärte: Besser. Und dann ging er ins Badezimmer, um zu sterben. Gut möglich, dass er keine Ahnung hatte, dass er ein paar Sekunden später das Bewusstsein verlieren und neben der Toilette zu Boden sinken würde. Gut möglich, dass er log, um mich zu schützen, aber die letztendliche Erklärung und die, die ich am ehesten glaube, ist die, dass er wusste, dass er sterben würde und fest entschlossen war, eine letzte Pointe zu landen, zum allerletzten Mal noch einen draufsetzen. Und das nötigt mir verdammt großen Respekt ab. Die Vorstellung, dass der letzte Gedanke meines Vaters, während seine Sicht verschwamm und sich seine Lippen blau färbten, bevor er sich der kalten Hand des Todes anheimgab: Hab ich dich dran gekriegt, du kleiner Scheißer, war? Das hat etwas seltsam Tröstliches. Ich glaube, das würde ihm gefallen. 3 Wochen später feierte ich meinen 10. Geburtstag. Ich bekam ein neues Fahrrad, ich aß Kuchen, ich machte die ganzen Sachen, die man normalerweise so macht, wenn man endlich im zweistelligen Bereich angekommen ist. Ein paar Monate danach brachte ich von einer Preisverleihung in der Klasse den Titel witzigster Schüler mit nach Hause. Bis dato undenkbar, hatte ich doch eine tugendhafte, arbeitsame Haltung in der Schule, immer hart an der Grenze zum Lehrerliebling. Doch meine Trauer in etwas umzulenken, was andere zum Lachen brachte, war viel besser, als mehrmals am Tag weinend zusammenzubrechen, was ich eigentlich viel lieber gemacht hätte und was mir sicher gut getan hätte. Aber es ist schwer, gut mit so einem Trauma umzugehen, besonders wenn es die erste richtige Erfahrung damit ist, wie beschissen die Welt sein kann. Wenn man so etwas Schmerzliches erlebt hat, klammert man sich an alles Positive, und das manifestierte sich für mich vermutlich damals im Lachen meiner Schulkameraden. Denn dieses Lachen bestätigte mich und gab mir in gewisser Weise einen Sinn. Außerdem wollen wir uns doch nichts vormachen. Niemand will das Kind sein, das ständig um seinen toten Vater weint. Die absolute verdammte Spaßbremse. Als der Leichenbeschauer lange genug in der Hülle herumgewühlt hatte, die 51 Jahre lang meinen Vater beherbergt hatte, gab er einen tödlichen Herzinfarkt zu Protokoll und abging's mit Dad zu seinem feurigen Ende im Krematorium in Loughborough. Doch die Obduktion hatte auch erhebliches Narbengewebe zutage gefördert, das auf einen früheren Infarkt in den Monaten oder Jahren zuvor schließen ließ. Und das war uns allen neu. Kurz darauf fand meine Mutter in einer Jackentasche meines Vaters ein frei verkäufliches Herzmedikament. Und damit war klar, dass er gewusst hatte, dass irgendetwas im Schwange war. Doch Brustschmerzen, die schon einmal beinahe zum Tod geführt hatten, waren in seinen Augen anscheinend nicht so wichtig, dass man sich damit an einen Arzt wandte. Typisch Dad. Nach seinem Tod zog ich in fast allen Situationen den Witz der Aufrichtigkeit vor. Denn die Vorstellung, am Wundschorf herumzupulen und den zerbrechlichen Menschen darunter bloßzulegen, war so ungefähr das Furchterregendste, was ich mir vorstellen konnte. Ein Charakterzug, der auch meinem Vater eigen war und den ich jetzt als einen seiner größten Fehler erkenne, der zu seinem frühen Tod geführt hat. Aber viele Männer sind so. Es ist total typisch und das hat mich letztendlich dazu inspiriert, das zu schreiben, was ihr heute lest. Der sture Typ, der sich verlaufen hat, sich aber weigert, jemandem nach dem Weg zu fragen, ist eine weit verbreitete Karikatur, eine, auf deren Grundlage Leute wie Martin Clunes über 30 Jahre lang Karriere im Fernsehen machen. Aber dieser Typ wurzelt auch in einer sehr realen, sehr destruktiven Vorstellung von Männlichkeit. Das Oxford Dictionary definiert Männlichkeit als Besitz der Qualitäten, die traditionellerweise mit Männern in Verbindung gebracht werden. Von jungen Jahren an werden wir darauf abgerichtet zu glauben, Schwäche einzugestehen, wäre irgendwie schon selbst eine Schwäche. Und es gibt eine Reihe düsterer Statistiken, die belegen, was für ein Riesenproblem das ist. Selbst wenn man den Bereich der Reproduktionsmedizin mit einrechnet, gehen Männer im Schnitt nur halb so oft wie Frauen zu ihrem Hausarzt oder ihrer Hausärztin. Und man braucht kein Genie zu sein, um einzusehen, dass das ziemlich blödsinnig ist. Es scheint doch ziemlich unwahrscheinlich, dass Frauen doppelt so oft krank werden wie Männer. Im Vereinigten Königreich ist die Zahl frühzeitiger Todesfälle, jünger als 50 Jahre, bei Männern anderthalb Mal höher als bei Frauen. Hauptsächlich aufgrund von Herz-Kreislauf-Erkrankungen, Unfällen, Selbstmorden und Krebs. Wobei die letztgenannte Todesursache womöglich der stärkste Beweis für das Zögern der Männer ist, Hilfe zu suchen. Hautkrebs zum Beispiel betrifft Männer und Frauen gleichermaßen. Doch es sterben doppelt so viele Männer daran. Denn wir befassen uns erst damit, wenn es zu spät ist. Der Unterschied bei den Selbstmordraten ist der nächste Augenöffner. Obwohl Depressionen bei Frauen weitaus häufiger sind, ist die Wahrscheinlichkeit, dass britische Männer sich das Leben nehmen, dreimal so hoch wie bei Frauen. Ein Bericht der Samariter aus dem Jahr 2012 kommt zu dem Schluss, dass das soziale Konstrukt von Männlichkeit eine der Hauptursachen für dieses Ungleichgewicht ist. Der Bericht stellt fest, dass Männern von Kindesbeinen an beigebracht wird, männlich zu sein bedeute, keinen Wert auf soziale und emotionale Kompetenzen zu legen. Und im Gegensatz zu Frauen bestehe die gesunde Art, wie Männer klarkommen, darin, mit Hilfe von Musik oder Sport, mit Stress oder Sorgen fertig zu werden. Und nicht mit Reden. Auch Alkoholismus ist bei Männern viel weiter verbreitet als bei Frauen, was wohl hauptsächlich damit zu tun hat, dass Männer psychische Probleme gern mit Alkohol behandeln. Mein Großvater väterlicherseits hatte im Zweiten Weltkrieg gekämpft und den Krieg zwar de facto überlebt, doch der unsagbare Horror, den er mit angesehen hatte, hatte seine geistige und psychische Gesundheit so untergraben, dass er kaum noch zu etwas anderem imstande war, als zu trinken. 6 Jahre nach der Landung der Alliierten in der Normandie geboren, wuchs mein Vater, wie viele Kinder jener geburtenstarken Jahrgänge, mit einem Vater auf, der ihn wegen seiner tiefen emotionalen Verdrängung nicht lieben und erst recht nicht über seine Gefühle sprechen konnte. Es ist ein vererbtes Leiden. Männer werden von Männern aufgezogen, die emotional nicht kommunizieren können. Die Symptome, die wir heute als PTBS, posttraumatische Belastungsstörung, kennen, sind zum Synonym für Männlichkeit geworden. Wenn man mal darüber nachdenkt, ist das alles total beschissen. Das ist natürlich noch lange nicht alles. Frauen, die durch das Misstrauen ihrer Männer gegenüber Ärzten zu alleinerziehenden Witwen werden, müssen diesen Kollateralschaden quasi ausbaden, während wir Männer mit unserer Unfähigkeit zur Kommunikation ja schon von Anfang an jeden Versuch sabotieren, einem anderen Menschen wirklich nahe zu kommen. Nicht zufrieden damit, den Tod meines Vaters für das Schreiben noch einmal zu durchleben, kam ich auf die eigentlich doch ganz gute Idee, meine Ex-Freundin Megan zu bitten, mir zu verraten, welche speziellen Probleme sie in der beschissenen Zeit, als ich ihr Freund war, mit ihr hatte. Ich glaube, das größte Ding war, dass deine Unfähigkeit zu kommunizieren es dir schwer gemacht hat, deine eigenen Gefühle überhaupt wahrzunehmen und zu verarbeiten, sagte sie. Noch mehr als deine Unfähigkeit, sie mir gegenüber zum Ausdruck zu bringen, warst du es so gewohnt, alles wegzudrücken, dass du den Kontakt mit der Realität deiner Gefühle verloren hattest. Selbst wenn ich mit dem Finger auf eine problematische Situation zeigen konnte, hast du sie schlicht geleugnet. Ich musste schwierige Themen also nicht nur durchackern, sondern stand schon vorher vor der unüberwindlichen Aufgabe, dich dazu zu bringen, zuzugeben, dass da überhaupt etwas durchzuackern war. Wie jede und jeder in einer glücklichen Partnerschaft einem sagen kann, ist Kommunikation der Schlüssel zu einer guten Beziehung. Und natürlich nicht mit Kolleginnen oder Kollegen ins Bett zu gehen, das hilft auch. Und das Schlimmste ist, dass wir das wissen. Sämtliche Bücher und Fernsehsendungen, die sich mit solchen Themen befassen, hämmern es uns ins Hirn. Aber wir ignorieren das munter und brettern in der irrigen Annahme, diese Regeln würden nur für andere gelten, einfach weiter. Und was zum Teufel können wir dagegen tun? Es ist leicht, die Sache als aussichtslos abzutun, als zu fest in unserer Kultur verankert, um je wirklich etwas daran ändern zu können. Die Persönlichkeit der halben Weltbevölkerung lässt sich nicht über Nacht verändern. Und das ist gut so, denn Selbstironie, Zynismus und leichte Formen passiv-aggressiven Verhaltens sind ja nicht nur schlecht. Aber versuchen könnte man es. Und zwar mit etwas ganz Einfachem, mit Reden. Wir tun das jeden Tag. Warum also nicht über das, was wirklich wichtig ist? Wir haben sehr viel Übung darin, den Mund auf uns zuzumachen, um Laute zu produzieren. Wir müssten diese Laute nur ein wenig variieren. Dann könnte am Ende etwas dabei herauskommen, was uns richtig gut tut. Dankeschön.
Thank you very much, Ulrich, for reading. And thank all of you for being here. It's quite overwhelming, the interest that you are showing for this book. And yeah, are we going to share one microphone, or maybe are we having two? HX, so now you also have a voice. Great. So yeah, when I'm looking in the audience, there are not only women, but I would say mainly women, but also a lot of men, but more women. Is this, and I guess since I know some of the people, I know that some of you have already read a lot of gender studies literature and so on, and is this the audience that you imagined when you were writing the book?
It's pretty much what I expected. I mean, my experience from, you know, the very first thing I wrote on this was that the people who were most interested in it were women. I think that kind of makes a lot of sense. You know, we talk about the toxic behavior of men, this is something that for most of history has, you know, there's been no real cause for men to kind of evaluate our own behavior because we've been at the top of the social structure. So, you know, no matter how we behave, like, we're still gonna, you know, have everything handed to us. So women have kind of been interested in this for much longer than men. I think we're getting to a turning point now where more men are starting to become aware of the kind of the dangers of their behavior, but it is still very much women who are kind of at the forefront of this conversation who I think care the most about it. So yeah, this is pretty much what I expect from this kind of event.
So yeah, I mean, your introduction, the introduction in the book ended with that we need to talk, so that's what we are going to do now. And I have to say that Jack and me, we already talked. To each other, we did an interview, and I was thinking, like, I don't want to, like, reenact the interview we already did. And so I started to look into your book again. And actually, you raise like questions yourself, three main questions, and I just want to refer to them. You raise them in the end of your introduction. And so, yeah, I kind of want to give them back to you. And like the first question is, why have we ended up like this? And I think we have to talk about first, before you answer the question, what exactly is this? And also, what is we? Because you tend to always say we, and I think you mean men, but you mean all the men everywhere? Or it's like, who is the we? And who are the men you are really writing about in your book?
So in terms of the we, I think there is a kind of universality to a lot of this. I think you kind of... from speaking to people here, it seems that, you know, these definitely aren't problems unique to British men. But I've definitely come at this from the point of view of a straight, cisgender, white man. And, you know, I don't want to speak on behalf of any other cultures, because I think there are kind of unique issues within, you know, race and religion, for instance, that I'm not really qualified to talk about. But so, you know, there is a kind of... it's very much me who I'm writing about here. But at the same time, I think it's kind of, it's clear from speaking to people around the world that, yeah, these problems don't exist in a bubble, and that there are certain behaviors that are just kind of common amongst men absolutely everywhere. In terms of this, that's a trickier one. I think we're at a place now where a lot of men are kind of feeling a bit lost in the world. They don't feel like they have the same kind of defined structures that they once did. And that's entirely through our own fault. I think a big part of it is the changing way in which we work. And with, you know, for the past kind of 60, 70 years, we've started to see more and more women in the workplace. And it's gone from being the domain of men to, you know, it's a much more equal thing than it once was. And so for men, we used to be very defined by the fact, you know, we went out, went to work, and provided for our families, and that was kind of, that was our contribution to society. And I think for a lot of men, they kind of feel like now that women are doing that, their masculinity has been challenged. So we're kind of seeing a lot of, you know, what I would call toxic masculinity as a result of this. And we're at a stage now, and this is something I largely trace back to the two world wars, where we have a real issue when it comes to talking and, you know, emotional openness. And yeah, like I say, this kind of traces back to a period, you know, on a personal level, my grandfather fought in the Second World War and came back completely traumatized by the horrors he'd seen. And this was in an era of very poor understanding of mental health. You know, the term post-traumatic stress disorder wasn't coined until about 20 years after. So he really, you know, all he felt able to do was drink. And as a result, he, you know, my father grew up without a father who was able to show these emotions, to really love. And that got passed on down to my father, and in time, you know, passed on down to me. And it's taken a long time for me to kind of break free of this this kind of chain, and, you know, realize that my inability to talk about my feelings and to talk about my mental health is really harmful. So yeah, we're at this stage where there's a lot of men who just, they aren't capable of doing this because, you know, we've been taught to push this down for a very long time. And as a result, we're kind of at a crisis point in terms of mental illness. I think it comes up in the introduction that we're, in the Western world, men are, you know, between 3 to 4 times more likely to take their lives than women. So I think that's, it's clear that something is wrong and that, you know, masculinity plays a big role in this.
And in your book, you also describe how you, I think when you were a teenager, that you were like cutting, I don't know actually if cutting is the right word.
Yeah.
Cutting your arms. And in this time when you did this, did you have like the feeling that you have to talk about something? I mean, obviously you felt the urge to do something to your body.
Yeah. I mean, it's kind of sad that was the state I was in, that I think I needed some form of release, and that was how I chose to go about it, because in a way it seemed easier than talking about this. I went through several periods of relatively severe depression from kind of my early teens into my early 20s. And it was only towards the end of that I was able to even admit to myself that I was struggling with this, let alone talk to the people around me, because it just wasn't something I grew up, knowing how to do. The conversations you have as a young man, I think, on the most part, are quite superficial. And particularly amongst our peer group, we don't talk about these kind of serious things.
But this was, for me, like one part of the book when I thought, like, yeah, of course, but there are also a lot of young girls who do this and who have anorexia and who also don't talk about it. So I had this feeling like, okay, you can't talk, but also like in teenager in general, are not really good in talking about what's happening to them. And we did talk about this in the interview, but I want to ask the question again, why are you choosing to emphasize like what masculinity is and what femininity is, and how do you deal with it that you kind of also stay in this binary system?
There's probably a couple of different questions there.
Answer all of them.
In terms of the binary thing, as I said in the interview the other day, I would love us to get to a point where we don't see gender in this way. I think that, this focus on masculinity and femininity and, our kind of encouragement from birth that we have to kind of act a certain way based on our gender is, it's one of the most harmful things that we're dealing with right now. And there's no sensible reason for it. But unfortunately, I don't see us kind of moving past these old ideas of gender as a binary for a very long time. So I think we have to, as a short-term solution, kind of play into that and admit that this is how we view things and that there are issues relating to that. But otherwise, I think there are definitely, there are a lot of shared problems, particularly amongst young people, such as self-harm. But it seems for women, some of the time it is related to their femininity. You talk about anorexia, and I think there's definitely something that affects young women in a very serious way, and there's a lot of issues with body image there. But we have, at least in the UK, been quite aware of these problems in girls for a long time. There's been a lot of very kind of prominent campaigns, particularly with regards to how women's bodies are portrayed in the media, to kind of diversify that because of the issues of eating disorders in young women. And so we've been tackling this for a longer time than we have sort of the similar issues in young men. And I think there's kind of there's an exacerbation of particularly like eating disorders in young men, that it's seen as such a women's problem that it kind of acts as a further barrier to seeking treatment. And I spoke to a few men who'd suffered from eating disorders in writing this book, and they said that part of the thing that really delayed them getting help was because it was perceived as being a girl's illness, and so there's this extra barrier to it. So I think there are definitely unique things faced by all genders, but there's kind of there's something a little bit more for when it's men. They have an extra thing to deal with.
So let's come back to the original question, like, why have we, you, ended up like this. You give like you start with a historic part in your book, and maybe you could explain that, how you come from the world wars to now.
So yeah, in terms of history, you know, we kind of our biologies defined gender roles for a very long time. You know, it made sense for men to be the hunters because they tended to be a bit more physical. But really, most of it comes down to the fact that we didn't have the organs to produce milk, so we were unable to be the kind of the primary child carer. Which it kind of seems like a cruel irony that for a good portion of history, women were forced into this role as a result of what some might call their biological superiority. It was because of what women could do rather than, you know, what they could not, or vice versa. So, you know, for a very long time, this defined us. And then as humans evolved and, you know, invented milk formula and breast pumps, we got to a stage where it was no longer necessary for women to be at home with the kids at all time. You know, once these things started to, you know, become available, there was absolutely no reason for gender roles to be defined by women staying at home and men going out to work. And yet, clearly, it's taken a very long time to catch up to this. And, you know, like I said before, the World Wars played a really big role in this, particularly the Second World War. After, you know, 6 years of women taking on the men's jobs because the men were off fighting, we got to a point where at the end of the war, there was, you know, so much kind of social change happening. We weren't going to return to these old ideas. You know, women weren't going to be satisfied with going back to just being mothers. And so that kind of really started our push to, you know, more diversity in the workplace. Unfortunately, at this time, while this kind of revolution was happening for women, men, although we could have had a similar revolution of our own and said, well, if this is the case, if more and more women are going out to work, then why don't I stay at home and look after the kids? We chose to push back against this, and we still do today. I think a lot of men's rights activists blame feminism and blame kind of the women's rights movement for this this feeling amongst a lot of men that their place in the world is lost, that they, you know, are becoming redundant, when in actual fact, that's just our fault for not taking on some of those more traditionally feminine roles. And so this is kind of, for the past 60, 70 years, women have really evolved and kind of broadened their horizons in this way. And men only now are really starting to, you know, turn this around and say, okay, maybe fatherhood's not so bad. Yeah, and unfortunately, we're still at a point where a lot of men would prefer to regress to these past ideals rather than accept that this change has happened and that maybe, you know, we need to look at how we can grow.
Mm-hmm. You already said a bit about this, but the second question you raise in your introduction is how are we hurting those around us? So it's like, what harm do you see is done by toxic masculinity? And maybe you could like also give us some words about how do you see toxic masculinity, like sure. A definition.
It's obviously kind of a fairly long-winded thing to describe. You know, I spent most of a book doing that, but I like to think of toxic masculinity as, there is, you know, masculinity, and it doesn't have to be a bad thing. You know, there are a lot of ideals associated with it that are quite admirable. You know, we have this idea of strength and bravery associated with masculinity, and that can be absolutely great if it's done in the correct way. Whereas toxic masculinity is kind of our understanding of these ideals becoming warped. And so we see strength and bravery as meaning, you know, we need to be violent, we need to fight other men to prove our masculinity, when in reality it could be about, you know, standing up for your loved ones when they're under threat, rather than, you know, getting drunk and getting into fights on a Friday night. In terms of how we're hurting those around us, I think, you know, a good example is, you know, for me personally, I believe that, you know, one of the reasons I lost my father at such a young age was because of his kind of his inability to open up, and because of how that kind of fed into his idea of masculinity. It's, you know, it's very difficult to say whether he would have lived if he'd been a bit more open, but I know for a fact that had he told my mother that he'd been suffering from chest pains, then she wouldn't have taken no for an answer. She would have forced him to go see a doctor, and I think that could have changed things. So, yeah, quite suddenly we were left without, you know, without my father, and that kind of, that had an enormous effect on us as a family. You know, we were plunged into grief, and it all kind of seems a little bit unnecessary. And likewise, I think a lot of relationships are harmed by men's inability to communicate. And unfortunately, when we get to the stage where we're able to open up to anyone, it tends to be the first person we're kind of, we're able to do this with, or the only person we're able to do this with, is our partners. And it's a kind of unfair burden to place on a single person that you have to share all of your problems with them. And I think if we get to a stage where men are kind of comfortable talking, particularly with other men, you know, in their peer groups, then it kind of, it spreads this weight a little bit, and it means that one person doesn't kind of have to face all that emotional labor. Because I think it's a hell of a job for, you know, I'm generalizing here as straight men, but a lot of women have to deal with, you know, angry and misunderstood, I guess, selves, because we're unable to talk to anyone else about it. And yeah, that's just clearly not fair. And I think that puts an inordinate amount of pressure on those around us.
I think a lot of people, especially in these days, when they think of toxic masculinity, they think of one person with the name Donald Trump. Would you say he's like the personification or something of this construct?
Yeah, I mean, this is a man who, in spite of being accused by numerous women, including minors, of sexual assault, who was recorded bragging about sexually assaulting women, whose entire campaign was run on a basis of misogyny and this kind of male violence, was still able to become president of the United States. So I think it's funny, looking back on a year ago when I finished writing the book, I'm kind of full of optimism. It feels like we're at a turning point for gender. There's still hope that we, you know, something can change. And then this happened. And a year on, it feels like, you know, the next 4 years are going to do a generation's worth of damage. But at the same time, I am still optimistic. The backlash against Trump has been so huge, you know, particularly the women's marches that we've seen around the world, and you know, the number of men in attendance at those things suggests that there are still people who, you know, won't stand for this, who want to make progress on this. But it's unfortunately given a voice to these kind of angry young men who, for a period, you know, these problems never went away, and I think America's problems with sexism and racism have always been there, but for, you know, a significant amount of time, there was still kind of, you couldn't be open about these things. There was still some shame attached to behaving this way, whereas Trump has kind of reignited an entire generation of young men and said, it's okay to behave, you know, in a completely misogynistic way. You can still get to the top job in the country if you do this. And, you know, it's something that we're seeing across the world, you know, particularly in Europe. The rise of the far right is really kind of fueling this violent and, you know, toxic masculine behavior. So it's an incredibly worrying time. And unfortunately, yeah, from a year ago, my optimism of this definitely dwindled.
What do you say? What is his problem? You know, it's he has money. He obviously has a beautiful wife. He has children. He's the president of the United States. What would be your explanation?
He's a very insecure man. And, you know, he spends hours ranting on Twitter about journalists and anyone who has kind of challenged his power and, by extension, his masculinity. You know, he, during the Republican debates, you know, there was a lot of jokes going around about his small hands, and obviously people were equating that with the size of his penis, and he clearly hated that. The idea that anyone would challenge the size of his penis, and yeah, by extension, his manhood, it clearly got to him. So I think it's, yeah, it's obvious that he's a very insecure man. I think in some respects, he has the mind of an adolescent boy who's sort of feeling like his masculinity is constantly being challenged and is reacting to this by overcompensating in every way possible.
You used to live in Great Britain, now you live in Toronto, and you have a beautiful president. how is the perspective on everything that is happening in the US right now from Canada?
A lot of Canada's identity is tied to not being the US, and you know, it hasn't been as strong as this before now. I think above all, there's kind of a sense of relief that we are north of the border. You know, we have our sexy prime minister. And I think, you know, for Justin Trudeau's flaws, he is kind of the complete opposite of Trump. Here is a man who has kind of openly called himself a feminist, who's, you know, being supportive of women's rights to some extent. A lot of his campaign promises are now starting to fall through, but he has been a voice for these people, and he's shown that you can rise to the top, you can support women. You know, one of the first things he did was ensure that his cabinet was at least 50% female. And you look at Trump's cabinet picks, and you know, it couldn't be further from that. So I think we're kind of at a point where, in Canada at least, young men can look to this leader and see that this is someone who is admired. He is, you know, he is an icon in terms of sex appeal as well as in terms of politics. And I think that means a lot to young people, that this man can be so admired on so many different levels, but not have to be incredibly sexist to get there.
But it's of course also a lot of lookism involved there. what was I going to ask you?
You're too mesmerized by Justin Trudeau.
Actually, I wanted to stay.
That's all
there.
Any of us can think about.
Yeah, I was thinking like, okay, if Trump is the personification of toxic masculinity, is Trudeau like the role model of like maybe some new definition of masculinity, and if yes, what would this definition mean?
Yeah, I think there really is something to that, and we still unfortunately equate masculinity with power, and so, you know, like I said before, I would ideally like us to get to a stage where we don't think of it in terms of these binaries. And I think it's kind of unfortunate when we talk about people at the top of their game. If we talk about, you know, top female CEOs of companies, they're generally spoken of in terms of how much like their male peers they behave and how they kind of, they have to be ruthless and masculine to get to the top. So I think for anyone who is at the top of their game, be it in politics or business, there is this inherent idea of masculinity attached to them. But fortunately, in the likes of someone like Trudeau, who is, you know, he is a new breed of man. He's kind of, he's the loving father. He's, you know, like I said, he's a sort of proud feminist and supporter of women's equality. I think that for young men, you know, growing up in Canada right now, they have a leader they can look to and see that you don't have to be a Donald Trump to get here, and you can become the prime minister and treat women right at the same time, and it doesn't, you know, you don't have to be defined by this kind of ultra masculine thing. But yeah, I don't know if that answers the question or not.
It's okay, we can continue with a bit of reading maybe. Ulrich, I would ask you to read, because we are now going to listen to the final little chapter of your book, which is unsurprisingly also about masculinity. And yeah, maybe we can listen a bit more and then talk about it.
Männlichkeit ist nicht in der Krise. Sie ist nur verwirrt. Die Eigenschaften, die wir als männlich erachten, sind an sich absolut bewundernswert. Doch in unserem Streben danach tilgen wir ihre wahre Bedeutung und jagen am Ende idealisierten, oberflächlichen Versionen hinterher. Aber Abkürzungen gibt es nicht. Man kann sich nicht einfach männlich geben. Es ist ein komplexer Zustand, der weit mehr Balance und Fingerspitzengefühl erfordert, als wir wahrhaben wollen. Kraft, Mut und Draufgängertum können wunderbare Charakterzüge sein, aber nur in den richtigen Händen. Und Männlichkeit ist sehr viel mehr, als oberflächlich zu erkennen ist. Wenn ihr versucht, einen idealisierten Zustand von Männlichkeit zu erreichen, habt ihr euer Ziel schon verfehlt. Wahre Männlichkeit ist etwas, was ihr euch verdienen müsst, indem ihr euer Gender so nutzt, dass alle etwas davon haben. Viele Männer hegen den Glauben, Hypermaskulinität würde sie für Frauen attraktiver machen. Sie haben aber nur eine sehr verworrene Vorstellung davon, was Männlichkeit eigentlich ausmacht. Folglich ist ihre Haltung gegenüber Frauen oft eine Katastrophe und macht sie ironischerweise unattraktiv. Bestimmte männliche Eigenschaften können in der Tat attraktiv sein, doch viele Männer begreifen bedauerlicherweise nicht die Feinheiten männlichen Verhaltens oder in welchem Kontext es akzeptabel ist. Sie versuchen selbstbewusst zu erscheinen und kommen nur arrogant rüber. Sie möchten energisch sein und wirken nur barsch. Sie haben kein wahres Selbstbewusstsein. Ihre Bemühungen, männlich zu erscheinen, basieren eindeutig auf einer willkürlich zusammengestellten Liste. Vor allem aber begreifen sie nicht, dass Männlichkeit nicht das Gegenteil von Weiblichkeit ist. Ja, in unserem Bemühen, männlich zu erscheinen, lassen wir allen gesunden Menschenverstand beiseite und treiben es ins Extrem. Man sagt uns, es wäre nicht sexy, allzu emotional zu sein. Also schlucken wir, um das bloß zu vermeiden, alles runter, wo es in Wirklichkeit auch darauf hinausläuft. Vielleicht bei der ersten Verabredung nicht rüberzukommen wie ein betrunkener Highschool-Dichter und nicht versuch, so roboterhaft wie möglich zu erscheinen und gib bloß nicht zu, überhaupt etwas zu empfinden. Von Gleichheit profitieren wir alle und Trennung schadet nur. Durch den Feminismus haben Frauen den Sexisten bewiesen, dass sie alles können, was Männer können. Und zum Großteil ist das Leben dank des Feminismus in säkulären westlichen Ländern heute besser als an irgendeinem Punkt in der Historie. Jetzt aber ist es an der Zeit, dass die Männer beweisen, dass sie alles können, was Frauen können. Weder werden uns unsere Schwänze abfallen, noch Fußball aufhören zu existieren und niemand wird uns zwingen, in einem Rüschenkleid und High Heels herumzutanzen. Aber Frauen werden uns nicht verurteilen, falls wir Bock drauf haben sollten. Wir können immer noch die Frau für den Abend daheim lassen und mit den Lads in den Pub gehen und allen Scheiß der Welt labern. Doch danach leiden wir, wenn wir ganz unten am Tiefpunkt angekommen sind, nicht mehr still vor uns hin, sondern schaffen es mit Hilfe der anderen durch die dunkelsten Stunden und gehen auf der anderen Straße siegreich darauf hervor. Es wäre nicht das Ende der Männlichkeit, sondern ein Anfang. Und es wäre nicht ganz so verdammt miserabel. Dankeschön.
Vielen Dank. Jack, in this chapter we heard the word lad culture. This is something very British, and I think there are similarities to Germany, but maybe you could explain, like, what is lad culture and what is the typical lad guy?
So lad culture kind of really emerged in the 90s, and it was a sort of a pushback against the new man that emerged in the 80s. And so the new man was kind of, you know, as you would expect, more likely to kind of get involved with what was traditionally like a woman's domain. You know, he would kind of, he would happily do the housework, he would take care of the kids. And it was, yeah, it was this sort of new breed of male that was being championed. And then the lad was kind of, yeah, it pushed back against that. It kind of, it wanted to reclaim this idea of the ultra-masculine man. And it took a lot of its cues from working class culture, even though most of the kind of participants in lad culture were very middle class, kind of had office jobs. And
or singing in a band, like
being in Oasis. Yeah, it was kind of it was defined by a kind of a love of sports, particularly football, and you know, kind of heavy drinking and sexism, sort of objectification of women. You know, we had this. It's mostly died out now, but there was a period of media known as lad mags, and this was magazines that were, you know, it featured kind of, it was sort of softcore pornography, and then, you know, features on sports and cars and kind of masculine culture, so kind of like Vinnie Jones films and stuff. But yeah, it sort of, it claimed to draw from working class culture, but again, this was a sort of warped understanding of this. You know, these middle class guys looked at a working class that didn't really exist anymore and thought, oh, so this is kind of characterized by drinking too much and kind of being a bit leery and sort of getting into fights. The only thing that they didn't pull from that was the one thing that actually defined working class culture, which was the work. And it's still, you know, lad culture is very present in the UK. It's something that's kind of, it's a problem, particularly kind of in universities. It's behind a lot of kind of issues relating to rape culture, because it's, you know, it encourages this kind of, this objectification of women and kind of this goal of, you know, sex is kind of like the number one priority, by any means possible. So yeah, I guess that roughly explains what a lad is.
Yeah, and you say also, or you wrote in this part that true masculinity. So as you are talking about lad culture, it sounds like okay, this is like a wrong understanding of how to be a man, and that true masculinity is something that you have to earn. And how do you earn true masculinity?
It's kind of difficult to explain this, I think, without looking at you know, what masculinity is. And I think for a lot of people, their idea of masculinity is it's kind of very set in stone. It's kind of, you know, it's an old idea, and it doesn't really have too much room for movement. Whereas I like to see it as being, you know, something quite fluid, and the definitions change as society does. Because if we look back to, you know, early humans and how our gender roles kind of defined us, that was because, you know, it made the most sense at the time for the, you know, the progress of society as a whole. And obviously, you know, a lot has changed since then. So I think masculinity kind of needs to be defined by what men can do to further society and, you know, make this a better world for us all. And I think there are, you know, there are many privileges to being a man, and there are still, you know, if we're going to think of it in these kind of binary terms and kind of defined by our biology, then, you know, the fact is men tend to be bigger and stronger physically. And I think kind of new masculinity is using that, and, you know, using your privilege as a man to further things. So I think a good example of this is, you know, on public transport, we have a lot of issues in the UK with, you know, harassment of women. You know, guys will kind of, Yeah, we'll harass them, and there's a lot of videos of this on the internet in which no one says or does anything to prevent this, and you know, women are kind of left unprotected, and it's often other women who have to step in when, in actual fact, a kind of a big theme of all of this is that men only tend to listen to other men. You know, men only really care what other men have to say, and so we need to be the ones who step in and tell them what you're doing is wrong. And also we need to use the fact that we tend to be physically larger, you know, because it's going to, you know, be more of a presence against them. So I think, you know, there, like I said before, there are these kind of ideas of masculinity, sort of strength and bravery, and that needs to come out in a kind of a beneficial way for the whole of society and not just this kind of this superficial idea which equates violence with bravery, which is kind of the exact opposite way it shouldn't be going. Mm-hmm.
So earning true masculinity would mean to accept your physics and then yeah. To help.
I think, accept our physics and also accept the fact that as men we do have an enormous amount of privilege, and that, yeah, I think we need to be aware of this, and, you know, it's an inevitability, and you know, we can't do anything about this, and there's no use kind of just sitting around saying like, oh, you know, I'm privileged, but it's not my fault. This is just society, and like, okay, yeah, you know, use it for some good. Mm-hmm.
And you already mentioned a lot of times that there are some features that we imagine as masculine, as for example strength or courage and assertiveness. These are good qualities, but these are also qualities that, you know, support a certain system we live in. And what do you think about maybe making weakness a new coolness? and what role does the whole capitalist system
Well, like I said before, you know, when we look at women who are the top of their field, particularly in business, and they tend to be characterized by these sort of masculine things. It's a shame that this is the case, when I think there are so many aspects that we traditionally associate with femininity, sort of empathy and care, that I would really love to see everyone kind of strive for this and kind of adopt these things. It would make it a hell of a lot easier for everyone, and you know, it would make it a lot more pleasant. You know, there is no reason why you can't be strong and assertive, but you know, not a complete asshole.
But yeah, but it would also mean to maybe be less efficient because you choose to, spend time with your family.
Yeah, but I think that's something we need to accept, that we, unfortunately, because of, you know, the role of capitalism in our lives, everyone is encouraged to kind of strive for the ultimate when it comes to money and work. You know, I think it's clear that this is having a detrimental effect on our family life. France recently passed a law meaning employers can't force you to work outside of office hours, and you know, you're not allowed to take your work home with you. You know, you're not supposed to be answering emails during that time. And I think this is something really important that needs to happen throughout the world, because the way we work has changed, and unfortunately we're at a point now where in order to support a family in most of the Western world, you need to have two parents working. And as a result, it's making it a lot harder to kind of to have this time with our child. You know, you can't have one person go out to work and one person stay at home with the kids anymore. It's very difficult to do. So I think we need to move away from our kind of our worship of work and have a bit more time to kind of, you know, stop and consider an alternative, which is, you know, a bit more time with our family, a little bit less time at the office. Because unfortunately, capitalism is a very major part in what keeps these kind of these binary ideas of gender running. I often think about how, you know, 200-300 years ago, men never had to care about their appearance because, you know, the one thing you brought to a marriage was stability and income. And so it didn't matter how you looked. Whereas, you know, for a long time, it was only really women who were kind of targeted by, you know, at least in the kind of the 20th century, kind of targeted by brands and say, you know, like, you look ugly, you need to look better, you need to buy this. But we've seen more and more, you know, over the past kind of 60 years as women have gained independence and realized that they don't need to be with any guy just to survive now, that men have kind of had to put some effort into their appearance too. And this has been an absolute gold mine for, you know, clothing manufacturers, for people who want to sell gym memberships. And so, yeah, we've got to a point where anything that can sort of make you feel insecure in your body and, you know, make you want to buy something to change that will be harnessed and used against you. And so I think that is a kind of a major part of why for so long eating disorders were mostly associated with women, but why we've seen such a big rise in the last 20 years in men.
So I have like one more question. You can already start to think about your questions. And I want to close our conversation here on the stage with the third question that you raise in your introduction. And it is, what can we do to make men more of a force for good in this world?
I think I kind of already answered that, and I think it's that, men need to be aware of their privilege, and we need to kind of, unfortunately, there are many kind of societal structures that need to be dealt with before we can really kind of change things, but that's obviously going to take a long time. So in the short term, it comes down to the individual, and as I said before, men and white men in particular, because we've always been at the top of the ladder, we only really listen to the opinions of other white men. And so I think we need to be aware of this, and particularly within our friendship groups, we need to be the ones who stand up and say, you know, this behavior isn't right, because it doesn't matter if a man is told by a woman that he shouldn't be making a rape joke or something, because he's not going to listen to her opinion. He's going to say, oh, you know, she's overly emotional like every woman, you know, and kind of dismiss it. But if a friend kind of calmly sits him down and explains why this isn't a good thing to do, we actually stand a chance of, you know, him thinking about this and, you know, kind of hopefully remedying his actions in the future. So I think really, in order to make this change, it comes down to men, and we need to start with our friends and our peers.
And me as a woman, I can like lay back and just wait what's happening, or what's the role of women?
It's difficult because I think women have kind of done so much already in this world, and, you know, in terms of changing men. I don't think that any woman is going to sit back and just let this happen, because, you know, it's unfortunately for your benefit for kind of men to kind of change their behavior. I think it's for the benefit of everyone. So we all have our part to play if we want to make progress. But yeah, I'm definitely wary of putting this on women because of the kind of the emotional labor involved, and because historically, yeah, you have been the ones who have kind of picked up all the pieces of our stupid behavior.
Thank you very much. I'm the women. So are there any questions in the audience? There's already one hand. There are many questions. So there's one hand there in the back, and then later we move in this direction. Also erst der Herr im grünen Shirt und dann mehr rechts.
Guten Tag, ich bin Stefan Duflo. Ich hätte eine Frage. Und zwar, Sie meinte, diese neue Männlichkeit sollte man sich erkämpfen. Also, das sollte. You said we must learn with this new kind of masculinity. Like protecting women who are harassed in the transport. How is this different from your grandfather who went to war to protect his women and children from the Hun?
That's a really good question.
Thank you.
I don't think it's all that different. And I think, you know, as I said before, a lot of kind of modern ideas of masculinity the same as they once were, but unfortunately kind of what we have taken on to mean or to what we have kind of perceived as being masculine has changed, and like I said, kind of become warped and changed from our original ideals. So I don't actually think there is a huge amount of difference in that respect. I think, I think in terms of, you know, protecting those around us, that's always been a kind of a masculine trait. But for a lot of men, they have kind of missed the point with this and taken it to mean, you know, getting into needless fights with strangers. If that answers your question at all.
Thank you. Da jetzt mal, was sind so viele? Also ich glaube, die Dame mit den blonden Haaren, Rückkopplung, genau, ich zeige auf dich und genau, und da sollte das Mikro hingehen.
So there's like a few things that I'd like to say. It's like first, I was like, the first thing I was stopped at was when you said that the suicide rate of men is larger than that of women. I think like that they just use different methods, not like it's like the same women try as often as men, it's just that men are often successful.
So
that's kind of an important difference as well.
Yeah, that's a really good point, and there's a lot of research to support that. But it still, it kind of relates to this idea of masculinity. For a lot of men who are kind of, you know, in the depths of despair, they see suicide as kind of their final act of control. And unfortunately, failed suicide attempts are kind of seen as emasculating in themselves. You know, it's kind of considered this thing that if a man can't successfully take his own life, then he's even less of a man than before. So I think it kind of, that is part of the reason why men tend to use more violent methods, and unfortunately, part of the reason why the suicide rate is so much higher.
Okay. Another thing was like, you're like talking about that you don't want this gender binarity to be there, but at the same time you just use it a lot by just like making this difference up. And I get why you're doing that, but it's like, I think there's like a lot of things that are critical about that, especially when you're talking about how someone has to earn masculinity by helping women. And it's like you literally said, if a guy makes a rape joke and a woman would say, hey, you shouldn't do that, he would like laugh at her. I think this is like, again, just like this thing, like, okay, like men are saving the women because otherwise, like, the women couldn't do it themselves. Like, that's, I don't know, that made me feel a little funny. Also, when you said, you're like referring a lot to white straight male. What's different about gay guys? Like, they grew up the same way. They are men as well. Like, why do you take them out of this whole thing?
I mean, that is something I do address in the book, but. Honestly, a big part of it is that I am not a gay man, and I don't want to speak on behalf of them. It's the same with race and religion. There are some very unique issues relating to masculinity within the gay community, and I think particularly with regards to misogyny, I think there's some really interesting stuff I've read from people within the kind of queer community who sort of say that, you know, a lot of gay men kind of see themselves as having a free pass when it comes to sexism. But yeah, like I said, I'm writing from the point of view of a straight man, and I don't want to kind of to get too far in depth within a kind of a culture that, you know, I don't personally understand. And with regards to the kind of the you know, kind of reinforcing the gender binaries, I think I completely see your point on that, and it's something that I wish it didn't have to be this way. And you know, I think, like I said, long term, I would really like this to not be how we have these conversations. But unfortunately, I have kind of tried to reach out to, you know, some of the men who are kind of more likely to be affected by this behavior, or more likely to be perpetrators of this behavior. And it seems that often the best way to get through to them is by, you know, kind of using these old gender binaries. So I think it's, unfortunately, as a long-term thing, I agree it's damaging. And this is something I talk about. You know, there was, there's been kind of numerous campaigns in the UK for reducing male suicide, and it's kind of, it's centered around this idea that manly men take their lives too. You know, there was a big poster campaign by the Samaritans, a British charity, which sort of showed men in kind of traditionally masculine roles, so like a boxer, I think a soldier, and it kind of, it used this as a means of saying to men, you know, you can be manly and still be suicidal. And in terms of a long-term thing, I think that's incredibly harmful, because it is reinforcing this idea that there is still a kind of a right or a wrong way to be a man. But, you know, as far as I'm concerned, anything that can kind of reduce that in the short term is necessary. So it's at odds with each other, but I think we need to kind of address some of the more pressing issues first before we can start to move away from this.
Okay, but I'm still not sure if that works. If we like use again like this, men are physically stronger, and this is why they have to like stand up and help. I'm not sure if that this is the right way to go, to be honest, because I think this is just like, maybe it makes men more respectful towards women, but it still shows them that they're kind of like on a higher level, or that they can do the things and women can't do themselves. It's just like, I get your point kind of, but I'm not sure if that's like the right way to go.
Yeah, I mean, I totally get your point, and I honestly agree with pretty much everything you're saying there, but I'm personally, I feel like we kind of have to be realistic and pragmatic about what most of society still believes, and unfortunately that kind of means reinforcing these pretty backwards ideas. But yeah, no, I appreciate that.
Okay, can we agree to disagree then?
Es gab da drüben am Fenster genau zwei Wortmeldungen. Auch an anderen Orten, die später drankommen.
Hello, good evening, thank you. I'm interested in the fact whether your book has been translated in other languages as well, like...
No, this is the first translation.
In German, yeah. And are there any plans for other translations?
Not yet, hopefully so in the future, but yeah, not at this time.
Well, I'm thinking of particular languages. For example, let's take Japan, for example, because Germany and Japan are both industrial states. They have like huge, they have like a huge economic growth, and on the World Economic Forum, Germany is number 13 on gender gap, and Japan is like 115. Even though like they have like the same infrastructure and stuff, so I would be interested in whether people like countries of Japan or China or India or any Asian countries are interested in your books. If there have been like if there have been requests of translations.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, nothing at the moment. I would be fascinated to know too, and I think it's. You know, I wrote this without any intentions of, for instance, a German translation. This is this was an unexpected thing that happened. And honestly, it's quite surprising to me, because I went into it with quite an emphasis on British culture, because I think there's kind of, A lot of the problems with masculinity are exacerbated by, you know, we have what we call the stiff upper lip in Britain. It's this kind of, this widespread tendency just to not talk about anything. And so a lot of the problems are not just kind of related to men. There's a whole extra level, I think, with it being British, and there's kind of, there's definitely, yeah, an emphasis on Britain. You know, we were talking about lad culture, and again, that's something that it's a uniquely British phenomenon. So I honestly don't know how well the book would translate into other languages. I think a lot of it would get lost. I think it would kind of need to be reworked in quite a substantial way to kind of remove that focus on British culture.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Thanks.
Hey, so I was wondering, you said earlier that at some point you realized that your father's problem of not being able to talk about his feelings is one that you shared also. And I was wondering if there was like a turning point where you kind of consciously started talking to your male peers and like seeing how they reacted, and like, was there a lot of awkward silences or something that you like, let some of it go?
So for me, a big turning point in kind of learning to talk about this with anyone was my now ex-girlfriend, who kind of, she really kind of pushed at me to open up. And, you know, after that relationship ended, I had a bit of time to stop and consider it. And, you know, it became clear that a lot of the problems within that relationship was a result of me, you know, being so closed off. In terms of with friends, I think a big kind of catalyst for this was after the publication of the first article I wrote on the subject for Vice back in 2014, and it kind of, you know, it said a lot of what the book says, and I think a lot of my male friends kind of reached out to me afterwards, and, you know, kind of saying, oh yeah, this is, you know, this is something that we've never talked about, but I've gone through a lot of the same stuff. So it took me writing something, and this is kind of, in some respects, I found it a lot easier to write this very personal thing and have it published for the world to see than to sit down individually with my friends. Because that's just, it's such a difficult thing to do, and I think unless it comes up organically, which has happened from time to time, there never really feels like a good time to sit down and say, hey, so I'm really depressed. You wanna talk about this? Which I think it's part of the problem why this is such a challenge in kind of reshaping our thoughts on masculinity, because even now, as someone who has written this whole book on how we need to open up and emote, I'm still not great at doing that, and you know, there's still a lot of stuff I don't talk about with my friends, because it's just you know, it's something that I was sort of taught by society from a very early age that that's just not what men do. So yeah, even though now I can look at this and objectively see this behavior as unhealthy, it's still quite difficult to challenge it.
Yeah, there was one arm, and then more in the back, there was another person, and then we have two questions here. No? Okay, one question here.
I would like to go back to that reproducing of the binary thing and the gender essentialism. I was wondering if you're like doing this, and also the kind of fraternalizing like us as men, you know, as guys thing, to basically reach like a bigger group of basically heterosexual guys.
Essentially, yes. Yeah.
And then I was wondering if you think that this is a justified strategy.
I mean, like I.
You know, like just kind of like make the content more accessible, meaning more comfortable to them.
The thing is, I think other groups, other genders have been, you know, saying these things for a very long time. There's been many, many decades of feminist writing essentially saying what I have said. You know, I'm the first to admit that not very much of this that I have written is new or groundbreaking in any way. But the fact that it's been written by a man and in a kind of populist way is what has kind of It's why it's ended up published. And it's that kind of male privilege thing that I can just rehash what women have been saying for a very long time. And so I think for a lot of women and non-binary people and trans people, they've kind of been aware of these issues for a very long time and have probably gone a lot more in depth in their readings than my book goes. I essentially wanted this to serve as a kind of, as an introduction to this topic, mainly for cisgender straight men who wouldn't read about these things otherwise.
Okay, yeah, I see that, and I like, you know, the basic thing of you wanting to share your privilege and all. But still, I wonder if it's not, if it's really useful to, like, reproduce harmful shit like this, you know? Just to, like I said, make the content more comfortable. Did you have any difficulties with this?
In what way?
Like, did you think about if that's really useful? Because, sorry, but I'm pretty sure that, you know, like, not talking about these things at all is not going to make them go away. You know, you said that you wish we wouldn't live in a world like this anymore, which I think many people do, but I think not talking about them is not helping with that.
I mean, I do talk about them in the book.
Okay, so, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I go into kind of basics on, sort of trans rights and non-binary people. Again, to serve as an introduction, I think, because a lot of men still don't really have any real understanding of these things. It's definitely not a kind of advanced read for people already kind of well acquainted with the subject. It was sort of, it was very much meant as an introductory thing, specifically aimed at this group.
Thank you. There was a question more in the back. Oh, wasn't there? No? Okay. Then there's a question up front here.
I wondered, you were talking a lot about men caring for themselves and, like, on the mental health issues, and, like, not opening up enough to address problems that might grow bigger over time. And I wondered, isn't, like, a big part of toxic masculinity also that especially men are taking over responsibilities for other people and not addressing the issues that they're having with their responsibility and the inability to, like, fulfill the tasks that they are actually taking over?
I don't know if it's the case that men have any more responsibilities than any other group. I think we may kind of use that as an excuse at times to not address these things. And I know that, for a fact, you know, part of my trouble with kind of coming to terms with all this was I kind of, I had this false idea that I didn't want to be a burden on anyone. So all these people have their own problems, and I almost felt a responsibility to not unleash that on them. When, you know, after coming to this realization, sort of changing my behavior a bit, it became very clear that, you know, that was never the case with any of my friends and family. No one ever felt like I was burdening them by talking about these things. But I think for a lot of men, they do kind of try and use that excuse as a means almost of denying it to themselves above all else.
If you want to, like, ask one more thing.
I might consider making it clearer on the public transport example that we had, that it might do harm if a male person like myself are just going to take over the situation and take the responsibility, like, I have to help now and I have to get this cleared up, instead of just maybe offering help or, offering support instead of taking over the situation and taking responsibility without really knowing if it helps.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's probably poor phrasing on my part. I think that is absolutely how it should be. You know, I think that's, in these cases, I think we need to be aware of the complexity of the situation. We need to yeah, we need to not just step in and take things over and say, you know, a man is here, everything's okay. But I think we do also, you know, we need to make ourselves known and present, at least to the person who is being harassed, and kind of, you know, ask them if there is anything we can do.
Thank you. And then there's a question here.
Danke. Stefan Höhn vom Bundesforum Männer. Ich bin sehr froh, dass Sie das von der persönlichen Seite her schildern, wie Ihre, wie Männlichkeit ja, schwierig werden kann, vergiftet ist. Trotzdem, wir sitzen ja hier bei einer politischen Stiftung. Können Sie auch was dazu sagen, was für politische Rahmenbedingungen denn bewegt werden müssten, damit es uns leichter fällt, vielleicht auch uns selber in Bewegung zu bringen? Haben Sie da auch was zu geschrieben oder gesagt?
I have to translate. The question is, what are political options? What are options for politicians to I don't know, raise awareness or to support the change of society?
I mean, I think a big part of this is what has already been happening in a lot of the West. I think you know, an emphasis on elevating women's quotas, you know, giving you know, people who aren't men better opportunities, because I think a lot of this comes down to I think we're not going to start to address the kind of the problems of gender equality on the male side until we get to a stage where at least, you know, women are earning as much as men. I think that's kind of I think one of the kind of the major social things relating to this is parenting. And I think a lot of men would like to have the opportunity to spend more time with their children or whatever. But unfortunately, in the UK at least, paternity leave is, the allowance for that is significantly lower than maternity leave. You know, it's always favored the mother in this sense. And while I would like to see that changed, unfortunately, in most cases, it doesn't make financial sense for it to be the other way around because of the gender gap, because women are, you know, significantly more likely to be earning less than their male partners. We're stuck in this situation where it makes no financial sense for a father to stay at home with kids if he is the one who is going to be earning more money. So I think we need to address this in terms of, you know, gender equality on a much wider level. I think a kind of a lot of the issues associated with the male side of things will be resolved if we can provide better rights for women.
Thank you. There's a question.
In terms of politics and social transformation and the question from capitalism, I think we should think further. Because interestingly enough, you said that the working class has gone, which I wouldn't buy the argument. It's disaggregated, but it's still there. We have a lot of people in very precarious living conditions, even more after the financial crisis in 2007-2008. We have, by, as you mentioned, the French labor law, introduced in 2010 in Germany, the Agenda 2010, as it was called, still causes that a lot of children are living in poor conditions, actually, in a rich country like Germany. We have a kind of the division of labor between the sexes, which means that care work is biased by class and race. Still, who's going to do the care work for our older growing societies, including Great Britain? So I think class, gender without class, it's not the full picture, because that women gained support in the labor market is all the more adapted to middle class women and high qualified jobs. But we see on the other end of the working market that people have like really pretty shitty conditions again after labor laws have been abolished, or so we should like perhaps think about these things. And last idea in this context, you talk about toxic masculinity, but not about hegemonic masculinity, which is a concept introduced by Raven Cornell, herself in the meantime a transgendered person, and he in the former times and she now tries really to connect like different masculinities across the globe and how they are depending on each other. So maybe you might say some things about these ideas.
Yeah, that's a lot to say. No, I think that's really interesting, and unfortunately, it's something that, you know, kind of due to a lack of space and, you know, wanting to keep it simple, it's kind of largely ignored in my book. I think, unfortunately, we're at a place where the labor market in most of the Western world has kind of collapsed in on itself, and it's something that that is affecting us all. And I think, you know, I kind of want to return to the point of how once upon a time, you know, you could raise a child on a single income, and that is rarely possible these days. So I think there was definitely a kind of need to address this. I think stagnating wages and just poor working conditions, you know, compared to 20, 30 years ago, and kind of a drift away from unionization has really kind of has hit us hard. And I think, unfortunately, it's created this culture of competition. I think it pits everyone against each other in a race to the top. When in actual fact, I think it's a race to the bottom. I don't know how better to kind of explain that in terms of gender, but it's definitely a much wider social issue that unfortunately is very prevalent now, and I don't see a way out of it anytime soon. I think we've kind of got ourselves into a state, and there just doesn't seem to be this kind of political hunger to really address this. Unfortunately, everything's kind of moved to the right in the last few years. Was there anything kind of specific you wanted to?
I think this is really interesting, because that's also what happened with me reading the book, feeling like this is too simple. This is like under complex. Why didn't he think of this? Why didn't he read like all the other feminist writers and so on? But I think maybe this is also a strength from your book, that that people can read it who don't know what a cisgender man is, and that that people can like jump into the discussion. I think this is like, I mean, I can say it because you said so yourself, this is like not the book that will bring us intellectually on the super next level. But it's very interesting, because you are this white heterosexual man that we always talk about. And now you've written this book, and I think it's interesting, and maybe it's a nice present for friends of yours who are not not so deep in the debate. I think this is like really important to have a book that is not academic and who addresses some basic problems in a basic language also.
Yeah, I mean, I think everyone here kind of has a. I think everyone here probably has more advanced grounding in gender studies than kind of the intended audience of that book. It's absolutely sort of intended to serve as an introduction for people who don't really have much of a background on it, and for people who kind of shied away from it. I think for a lot of men, even, you know, the term gender studies is something that they'll switch off. It doesn't interest them in any way, because historically there's been no reason for it to interest them. It's definitely a very kind of basic introduction. It isn't complicated. It's a very kind of simple look at some of the kind of basic issues surrounding masculinity. And above all, I kind of wanted to encourage people to actually kind of check out some of the more academic stuff and some of the better feminist writers.
But if you are still interested in the book, you can buy it like over there. And you are also going to sign some of the books?
I've heard,
and then there will be maybe interaction with some of you. And thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
And have a nice evening, all of you.